Gee, Virginia, I bet you're the only person in the whole world to fail sex ed. He was in her room, lying on her bed with his head hanging upside down off the side, his fingertips barely touching the floor. Virginia sat on the bed, her arms folded around her knees. I bet I am. On Mars, they don't have sex ed. Virginia laughed. Sure they do. They have sex ed everywhere. Johnny shook his head. Well, maybe you can take it if you want, but they don't have it mandatory. See, on Mars, you don't even have to go to school if you don't want to. You mean there are no schools on Mars? She asked, teasing. Well, yeah, there are schools. There's just no law says you have to go. That's all. Daddy stuck his head in the door. Virginia, I'd like a word with you. She set her feet down on the floor. Okay. Johnny, do you mind? Daddy said, pulling a chair to her bed. Johnny left, dragging his feet. Daddy sat down. Virginia, some things just aren't worth it. She didn't answer, but stared at the embroidered picture of little Bo Peep above her bed. This isn't worth it, he said. Choose your fights where they can count for something. I'm not picking a fight, Daddy. I'm not doing this to make a fuss. You know I'm not like that. I just can't, that's all. He smiled bitterly. Sure you can. You can't imagine all the things you can do if you're desperate enough.
Hello, we are live. And our guest tonight is going to be David McElroy, the narrator of F on Audible, which is coming out very soon.
Gee, Virginia, I bet you're the only person in the whole world to fail sex ed. He was in her room, lying on her bed with his head hanging upside down off the side, his fingertips barely touching the floor. Virginia sat on the bed, her arms folded around her knees. I bet I am.
All my life, I've wanted to go to Earth. Not to live, of course, just to see it. As everybody knows, Terra is a wonderful place to visit, but not to live. Not truly suited to human habitation. Personally, I'm not convinced that the human race originated on Earth. I mean to say, how much reliance should you place on the evidence of a few pounds of old? We're also going to talk about Robert Heinlein's book, Podkayne of Mars. So I've been a fan of Podkayne of Mars for quite some time. This is my copy of the book. My copy has the happy ending, but I suspect David has listened to the copy with the sad ending. Hi, David.
Hi. Yes, I'm crying. I'm sorry. I had the sad ending.
Okay. Well, that must be why we had trouble getting together tonight.
That's it. Apparently, the people who don't like the book were trying to avoid us talking about it, you know?
That must be it. That and my ducks not cooperating with me trying to put them to bed.
Oh, I thought you meant you didn't have the ducks in a row or something.
Yeah, my ducks were not all in a row. So I have two ducks and a chicken in bed, and a duck, a drake and a duck wandering around saying, we don't want to go to bed yet.
Oh, that's so funny. Well, I have two cats in one room and I have Lucy in another room, and I just took her on a quick walk around the block so she wouldn't feel too cheated while I left her alone for a little while.
Good. So, what did you think of Podkayne of Mars?
I guess the best way to put it is I'm glad I read it. It or listened to it. It's a nice story. it will not ever be one of my favorite Heinlein stories. It's not bad. I don't mean it's bad, but it didn't have the depth that I feel like a lot of his other stories do. As far as the complexity of the story and things like that. Well, like when you compare it to things such as Citizen of the Galaxy, which is probably my favorite of his, Stranger in a Strange Land, obviously super weird book.
Yeah, very weird book. Yeah, so I'll admit, the first one you mentioned, I have not read, but of course I have read Stranger in a Strange Land.
The first time I read Stranger, I hated it. But I was so young that, I mean, because I grew up in a conservative Christian environment, you know, the anti-church stuff really, you know, threw me for a loop. And I had to get more mature to understand where he was coming from to where I could appreciate and enjoy it.
And you know, it's the communal stuff that got to me. I mean, I'm not a Christian, and so I didn't have any problem with that. But, you know, the communal living and all that was kind of weird.
Well, there's a lot of weird stuff in that book. But my only point is, it's deep and it's complex. But you need to read Citizen of the Galaxy if you haven't read that
one.
That I wish somebody would make a movie of. But anyway, to get back to where we are tonight, one of the things that I found interesting about this book, obviously, when was this published in 62? Do I have that about right? Do you remember?
Let me see. I'll look and see what it says.
It was
exactly
around
in the
book. Looks like this.
1963.
I wasn't too far. Books of this nature are products of their time, and you have to interpret them through that lens. After I read it, I was curious what other people thought of it. So I looked online and started reading other people's reviews. And I was like, look, this will never be my favorite Heinlein book, but these people are trashing it for the wrong reasons. And that annoyed me. You know what I'm saying?
What reasons? I didn't even read the reviews. So what are the reasons they trash it?
Because Podkayne is not a 2023 feminist.
But you see, that was when I read it. And the first time I read it, of course, it was in 63, but it was in the 70s.
Yeah.
And I was really, the criticism of Podkayne's parents for their child-rearing strategies, I thought that was very interesting.
Well, the stuff, you know, trashing him for writing this character, I just thought was over the top. If somebody were to write this precise book with everything about it today, you would say, well, you know, it's obviously some of the views or some of the ways that she looked at the world would seem out of date or very minority. But back then, you know, it was pretty progressive. You know, the idea of, you know, a woman was aspiring to be a space captain, you know, of an explorer ship. That's not the way people thought in 1963, right?
Well, I don't know. I mean, it depends on who was thinking. actually, I thought that she was very realistic. You know, so when I was a teenager in the 70s, I knew girls like that who said they wanted to be spaceship captains, but they really didn't want to be the captain. They wanted to marry the captain.
And that might be part of the problem for some of the people who are making this criticism. It might be that what you just said is a very realistic thing, but they don't want that to be true. They want everybody to want the same thing. What do you think?
Yeah. And please remember that Podkayne's mom was a career woman.
Mm-hmm.
So it's not like she came from a family where all the women were just knitting doilies or something. Yeah. So this isn't a criticism actually of, you know, the fact that women have minds or that they might want to take on a serious profession.
Right.
I don't think that's what the book is. But it is a criticism of choosing to raise children in a creche.
Yes.
Okay, I mean, that's really what it's criticism of. And I think it was ahead of its time because, you know, right now the reproductive technology has, you know, it's gotten about to the point where you could do that almost.
That's true.
And it wasn't that way in 63.
Mm-hmm.
So he's not criticizing, you know, career women per se. He's criticizing parents who leave the parenting up to, I don't know who, but not themselves, you know.
Hmm. Well, I think sometimes when people read books that were written in the past, they don't remember to interpret them through the lens of the way somebody of that particular moment in time would have looked at them. And I mean, I think they're mad because this book does not have the same worldview that I do.
You know? Well, I mean, people are always mad about that, but I think that the truly great books are books that are ahead of their time and that do have a point of view that people from much later generations can also get something out of. So even, mm-hmm. you know, if we're reading the Bible and we're reading the story of Ruth or the story of Judah and Tamar, in all of those cases, there are things there that, even though we're not part of that society and the rules of our society are different, we can still get something out of it because it's universal.
Right.
Don't you think?
Oh, absolutely. The best books have something that people can find universal truths in no matter when they're read. But some people approach every text trying to interpret it through the lens of their modern political and social views.
Yeah, sure, sure. I mean, that's like thinking the cavemen were just like the Flintstones. yeah.
Something I think you will understand this and appreciate this, and whereas I don't think a lot of people would. You know how the Nazis and the communists both, those regimes insisted that all art reflect the sensibilities of the regime.
Yeah.
It seems to me that the modern ideas about art needing to reflect what, you know, the consensus truth is a reflection of what the Nazis and the communists always were.
Oh yeah. Oh,
and
definitely.
I don't think people are willing to admit that, but well, because I mean, they don't understand history. Let's be honest.
Or they don't want to, or, you know, because I mean, half the people are stupid, but the other half are evil, right? And okay. They're not stupid. Yeah. So some people are stupid, but not everyone is.
Don't hide your views. Go ahead and tell us. Yes.
Okay.
Okay. They're stupid. We can admit it.
Okay. So what did you think about Podkayne's brother?
He was a fascinating character in part because of his age. What was it in Earth years? He was what? 11? Was it 9 or 11? Do you recall?
I think it might've been 9 and it was 11 by Mars years.
I found him to be reflect more of the thinking of an Earth kid of maybe a very bright Earth kid of maybe 13 or something like that. But regardless, yes, he was precocious. He was beyond his years, but he was a fascinating character.
Yeah. So what do you think about his motivation? Was it good, evil? How do you feel about it?
I don't know. I just don't know. And that's why I wish that he had written something else about this kid to find out. Because remember, most of the story, and I mean, I know you know this, but most of the story came from Potty's point of view,
right. Except
the end. And what's interesting to me, and you tell me if you think I'm wrong, I might be, but it seems as though the part that he narrated for us at the tail end after, you know, I'm kind of scared to give spoilers, but let's just say, I'll just leave it as at the end without saying after so-and-so happened. At the end where he narrates the section there, he comes across as a little more mature than he had in the actions that she had portrayed in her diary. Do you think that, or do you think, was I imagining?
Well, yeah, obviously, until I got to the end of the story, and of course, I read the happy ending, not the sad one, but until I got to the end of the story, I didn't think much of Clark. And then after I read that, I thought, oh my goodness, this is one of those classical peripheral characters. So, you know that in some books, there's a character that you think is a marginal character, a side character, not the most important. And then it turns out the book is about that person.
Right. Yeah.
And it's kind of like that. So it's really not about Potty. The book is not about Potty. It's told by Potty, mostly.
Well, I think it would have been fascinating if Heinlein had gone back and written something about what had happened to Clark in future years.
Well, it might have been, but in terms of, to me, Podkayne is a classic work. And even if he had written a sequel, it wouldn't have changed what this story is. I think this story is well crafted, whichever ending you take.
Yeah.
It's a very well crafted story. It's short. It's to the point. Well, except for all the stuff about changing diapers in the middle, but you know,
and baby floating in the air for a little while.
Yeah. Okay. So that's one of Heinlein's weaknesses. You know, if I were his editor, I would say, you're going to need to chop down that stuff about, but he would get into this idea that every person should be able to, you know, change a diaper, or affix a car or a motor or whatever, go out into outer space without a space suit and somehow fix something, that we should all be able to do everything.
Heinlein would be so disappointed in me. How does that quote go that says something like that? Everyone should be able to... Do you know the one I'm talking about? I think you're referring to that, but I don't know if it's a direct reference.
He probably said it more than once. That's what I'm thinking, because he really thought that.
Yes. Well, Heinlein's stuff reflects his work reflects who he truly was. It reflects the libertarian free spirit that he really was. Okay, here is this quote that you weren't directly referencing this one, but this is a quote that I love of his. A human being should be able to change a diaper, plan an invasion, butcher a hog, con a ship, design a building, write a sonnet, balance accounts, build a wall, set a bone, comfort the dying, take orders, give orders, cooperate, act alone, solve equations, analyze a new problem, pitch manure, program a computer, cook a tasty meal, fight efficiently, die gallantly. Specialization is for insects.
Yeah. I've definitely heard that before, and I don't remember which book that was in, but he said something similar in Podkayne of Mars, and he really believed that, and he believed that you should know how to plot a course and change a diaper. Yeah. And that was stated there, but he didn't have to show us how to change a diaper that many times.
Yeah, that's true. You know, I had never really thought about this directly, but what you're bringing up just is kind of making something click with me. This might be one of the reasons why I always loved Heinlein, because I am a generalist living in a specialist world. And that's probably why he means so much to me and meant so much to me as a child, because he wasn't trying to say, just learn this narrow thing and you're fine, you know? So.
Yeah, but I think that's also the difference between an introvert and an extrovert. Okay, and we have someone else here. Messi says, hola. Hola, Messi. okay, Yeah, so I don't know if you're familiar with Ayn Rand's segmentation of two people, and it's a binary thing, and obviously there are two kinds of people, the kind who decide that there are only two kinds of people, and then the other kind. But anyway, so Ayn Rand would talk about social metaphysicians, and this was a word, a pejorative. Those are the people whose view of reality is through the social lens, and they're the ones who always go to an expert to solve every problem. They will concede that they are not an expert in this, and they're not an expert in that, and they will concede that this other person has the expertise, and they will listen to that person. And then if they have this one narrow area of expertise, they expect you to listen to them, even if you have a cogent argument to make that something they said is not quite right. And we're living in that world. We have that world where if somebody is an expert on COVID, then you have to listen to them. You can't use your general logic with regard to, a field of expertise such as medicine. And if you do have a doctor who says the opposite of the medical establishment, you shouldn't listen to him either.
Well, and to me, the more all that is true, but the more important point is you are not allowed to apply your own judgment to
Yes.
your own life. We will
Yes.
force you to obey the experts,
Right. Right.
even if the
Exactly.
experts turn out to be wrong time and time and time again.
It doesn't
Doesn't matter.
matter because they're the
Right.
experts. So you should not think for yourself.
Precisely. Yeah, I
Yeah, Bo
agree.
is a chimpanzee messy and he's fine. He's asleep and safe. The only people I'm worried about right now in my menagerie are a drake by the name of Joey and a very new duck by the name of Francie, who are wandering alone in the dark because they didn't want to go to bed. So I think that Heinlein is definitely on the same side as Ayn Rand when it comes to thinking for yourself,
Right.
and making those decisions for yourself.
I had never heard what you just described from Rand. That must have been from some of her nonfiction, and I mostly read her fiction. So no, I never read that, but I can obviously see it reflected in her work, in her fiction. So
Right. Yeah.
because the people she liked were competent across the board. Actually, to an unrealistic degree at times, but we won't go there.
Yeah. Okay. Well, and in Heinlein, there are also, unrealistically competent people. Okay.
Heinlein's heroes could
Okay.
have flaws, though. That
Huh?
is, I Heinlein's heroes could have flaws, though. So I don't think.
Yeah, they had flaws. So what do you think about the uncle? All right, because we have these two kids, they're traipsing across the galaxy with their uncle who is some kind of diplomat, right?
Who is using children as this diplomatic cover? And later, he's like, "Oh, I shouldn't have done this," when he's about to get the kids killed. I can't say I like the uncle. I just looked at him as a plot device more than anything else. I didn't see him as that deep. I didn't care for him. He just seemed, like a pretty selfish guy who. I mean, Potty was lucky that she loved him, but he didn't really seem to have that much depth as a person. I mean, do you see it differently?
Yeah, I did see him a little bit differently. So he's the childless person who takes the children maybe more seriously than the parents who are too busy to raise their own kids. That's kind of how I saw it.
Yeah, but he's also willing to get him killed for his diplomatic mission
Well, yeah, but
without
see
letting
the
them know
whole
what they're doing.
Yeah, okay. But Clark is pretty devious and uses people too, so I
Cannot argue with you there. Clark was a little user.
Yeah, so I don't know. I don't know how I feel about any of that, but
Right.
it's just I think it's an interesting plot device. I think the characterization is deeper than you might think. Even Gertie. What did you think about Gertie?
I didn't dislike her. I would say she comes across as very likable. I didn't really have any strong feelings about her other than she seemed like an extremely nice person who turns out to be in a difficult position in life, and she was realistic enough with herself to say, "This is how I'm going to fix my problems."
Yeah.
That's the best I can say about her. That
Yeah,
seemed
Celia
reasonable to me.
has something to say. She says, I kind of see that happening. I mean, not saying it was right he was getting the kids killed, but maybe he cared more about their interests. So that's actually one of the issues for me in life. There are people who will tell you they really care about you and they're protecting you. And then they won't let you do anything. And then there are the people who will take you flying in an airplane upside down and all this. And there's a certain amount of danger involved with that. But they're taking you seriously and they're sharing their life with you. So it's one of those kind of things where it's hard to say, is it bad for an adult to ever involve a child in something dangerous?
Oh, no, I mean, obviously, I wouldn't go that far, but I would say that as the story went along, I found myself thinking at times, could he not have achieved the same thing by just going on a, some other trip to Earth by himself? Did it require the children's cover, is all I'm saying. So I don't know. I mean, I don't have strong feelings about it, but I do remember that I found myself wondering that as the book went along.
Yeah, so Julia says she kids used to do crazy things in the 80s. And I thought,
And
you know, they
before.
stopped doing that in the 80s as soon as I stopped being a kid. Anyway, they had more fun and were more independent. And I it's the same thing. Like right now, I'm really worried about those ducks out there. I actually do care about them. But
Do you mind if I respond to Julia just really quick? Because I mean,
sure.
I think she has a good thought. The distinction I would draw is this: kids used to go out and, say, "Mom, I'll be back by dark," or "I'll be back by 10 o'clock," or whatever. And mom didn't care in general, as long as they lived in a reasonably safe neighborhood. And children were allowed to, walk to school and would do all sorts of things that they would not be allowed to do today. I would simply say that is a great thing, but it might be a little bit different to say, I'm going to bring kids on a mission that these people are willing to kill for that might get them killed. So that's the only reason I might draw a distinction between those, but eh.
Okay, so let me tell you about another book that I wrote.
Okay.
And it's set in China during Japanese occupation
Ooh.
in World War II in a concentration camp.
Ooh, that's pretty
And
dark.
it is pretty dark, and something pretty dark happens to a little boy who is sent off by the people in the camp or certain people in the camp. To try to send a message to a Chinese resistance fighter to come and save them. Okay, and the question is, should you never ask a little boy to do that? I mean, is it wrong?
No, I wouldn't say that because it depends on context too. I mean, in a situation such as what you described, that's something where it could save the lives of a lot of people. And if he's in that camp, there's a good chance he's going to die anyway. So, I don't mean to sound cold, but that seems like a situation where it seems reasonable.
Okay. All right.
I was just saying that I'm not sure that the children's involvement was actually required to achieve what the uncle was trying to achieve. Maybe I'm wrong. I don't have a strong feeling about it, but
The thing is, the children really wanted to go, and their parents were not going to take them. And sometimes when you're going to go somewhere, you have to sort of pay the piper for the chance to go, which means a risk. I don't know.
Yeah. As I said, it's just a question that I thought of. It's not like I have some definitive opinion and I'm going to die on this hill.
Right. Yeah. Not asking you to die on the hill either way.
Hey, can I, before we move on the other book that you just mentioned, that's fascinating that you wrote that. What kind of source material had you read to kind of put yourself into the mindset of the way life was like in one of those camps?
To read a lot of firsthand accounts from that time. And in fact, the book, at the very end of the book, I give my source materials so that people can go and see which parts I made up and which parts are actually real. And you would be surprised how much of it was real.
Yeah.
And one of the interesting things about it is that the Japanese camp commandant actually had spent time in the United States and had been in an American internment camp and had been repatriated.
Fascinating.
And then became a camp commandant, you know, because obviously he spoke English and all that. So they gave him that job.
Wow.
And he actually wanted it to be a good camp, if there is such a thing as a good concentration camp. He wanted to be fair to the internees. And of course, they were Americans and French, allies,
mm-hmm.
All of the allies and British.
Right.
So he set it up so it was kind of democratic within the camp. Obviously, they weren't allowed to leave and there were all sorts of rules and you had to bow down to the guards. And, you know, obviously it was under Japanese rule, but he allowed the internees to vote on all sorts of things. And that didn't turn out well because democracy in and of itself does not make life better.
No.
And Julia said she liked Father Horvath. Yeah, he was a great character. So there were nuns, there were priests there who had been missionaries to China, and there were school teachers and all sorts of people and businessmen and you know, who got caught up during the war and ended up all sent to that place. And yeah.
How did I don't want to go down this rabbit hole because this is a totally deep thing that could be very difficult, but that would be a very dark thing to research. I've read some of the stuff that went on and some of it was just absolutely dreadful. How did to what extent did it psychologically?
This was one of the best. This is one of the best camps. I, for instance, I would never have written about one of the Nazi camps in under the Germans in Europe, because those were hopeless situations that just totally destroy people and, you know, break them down before they die and turn them into animals.
And a lot of the Japanese camps were. So that's
But this I'm glad you wrote the about best a one. Nicer one. Yeah, I chose to write about a nice one. It's not as sadistic as those others.
What era did you write the book? I'm just curious.
When did I write it?
Yes.
So I was in Taiwan. The reason this fell into my lap. I wasn't even aware there were internment camps of the Japanese in China until I went to Taiwan. And I taught at Providence University in Taiwan in Taichung. And this is a Catholic university. And the nuns had relocated there from China because, you know, right after the war, the communists took over in China. And of course, you couldn't have any more religion.
Right.
So they relocated to Taiwan. But there was one elderly woman in the convent who had actually been with the nuns in the internment camp.
Wow.
She was not actually a nun, but she served them. She was their servant, and she went with them. And so they were taking care of her in her old age to pay it back to her. And of course, there were no nuns from that era. The nuns were all younger, and there was this just one woman. And I sent a couple of my students to go talk to the older lady because I was interested in her dialect. Because she came from Kaifeng. So the nuns, the internment camp was not in Kaifeng. But the nuns had a school. They were missionaries and they had a school in Kaifeng. And so the woman who served them was from the Kaifeng area, and I was interested in her dialect, and I sent some students to talk to her, but she was too far gone in her old age for that to have worked. But anyway, that got me all interested in what actually happened and what was that school like that they ran over there. And so then I started reading biographies of different people, all of them ending up in that camp from different regions. They were, each of them was doing something different. Some of them were businessmen and they were there to trade. You know, there's a guy who represented an American tobacco, American and British tobacco company. And he ended up, escaping from the camp and joining the resistance.
Wow.
But a lot of the people were missionaries from various different Christian sects, and each in a different region, and they all ended up in the camp. And many of them then later wrote their memoirs. Hmm. And there were even children who were stuck there because they were the children of missionaries and had been sent to a boarding school in China, but were not with their parents. Hmm. And I don't know if you've heard of Eric Little.
No.
The runner, the Scottish runner who wouldn't run on the Sabbath.
Was he the one that the movie?
Yeah.
What's the name of the movie?
Chariots of Fire.
Yes. Thank you. That was going to drive me crazy. Yes, I didn't remember his name, but yes, I know about.
Oh, okay. Anyway, he became a missionary, and he died in that camp, but not because they starved him or anything. He had a brain tumor, so he died. So, yeah.
I didn't mean to take us down this road, so I apologize because I know you had an agenda, but I'm fascinated by the World War II camps and stuff like that, partially because I had a great uncle who was a German prisoner of war. He had been a bomber pilot and been shot down. And so I, heard some stories from him, but there was a lot of things he didn't want to talk about. And that was part of what's made me so interested as I grew up in World War II. And the thing about it is, if you read a lot of the source material, it can make you, hate Japanese or hate Germans and stuff like that. And then as you grow and mature, you eventually realize a lot of us would have been no different from they are. So it's not really...
Yeah.
It's not really about a nationality, and a lot of people.
No, it's not about a nationality at all. Right. And I think that it, in my book, it's not like that. I don't take a stand against Japanese. I don't take a stand against Chinese. There are good Chinese and bad Chinese. And because did you know that the communists were actually sniping at the nationalists at the same time as both sides were trying to fight the Japanese? So it was kind of a mess.
Chiang Kai-shek's bunch hated the Maoists and vice versa. So, yeah.
Hello, Angela. Glad you could be here. So it was really amazing. And the Japanese commander maintained that he was saving the prisoners from all the chaos that was going on outside. He was keeping them safe.
If he had been somewhat westernized by having spent time over here and maybe picking up some of our values, he might have sort of needed to believe that and actually do that in order to stay consistent with who he wanted to be. So that makes sense to me.
Right. And so he thought he was providing them with enough nutrition, enough food. But in fact, there was no free market in the in the camp. So a lot of the food that he had shipped in ended up rotting because they didn't know how to prepare it. And they would vote who would be in charge of the kitchen instead of, you know, letting the, So eventually what they had to do was barter for eggs from with the Chinese on the outside. And everybody risked getting shot when they were doing this. So,
You're better off if you just let the black market handle it.
Yes, absolutely. The black market is always best. And I think we're headed that way, which is why I'm, I've got that my flock of chickens. And but there's a lot of politics with that, too. You know, the, there's like, who's the top chicken?
Oh, absolutely. You're right.
Yeah. So. Would you like me to share a little bit about what's been going on in my menagerie?
I'd love to hear about that.
Okay, so we have a new dog, and his name is...
I've seen pictures. What's his name? I'm sorry.
Oreo. So let me show you. I just made a little movie about that. So Oreo is part German Shepherd, and part Pyrenees. He's going to be a big dog, but he's not big yet. And because he's not purebred, I didn't, you know, I didn't have to pay for him. I was able to adopt him free of charge. And we're hoping that, unlike my other dogs who just want to kill the chicken, that he will be okay. So far, so good, you can see. He's scaring everybody, but he's not hurting it.
He's not trying to get it into a primitive version of KFC yet.
No, not yet. What he does want to do is eat their food. I haven't quite figured out how to get him not to eat the food. And there was one moment when I kind of got him away so they could go in, and I put a lot of rice in for them to have. Uh-huh. And he was whining. You know how dogs whine when they want to get in somewhere? It was like, let me in. I want some of that, you know. And
that's
so I'm not, I'm new to this idea of trying to raise a dog to protect them. Mm-hmm. Before that, I was protecting them from my other dogs by having them separately. Farm dog sponsorship. What is that, Julia?
I don't know either. That's
okay. So meanwhile, I went to the feed store and I was going to buy some chicks, and I kind of went over. I didn't know what I was doing, so I got some turkey chicks as well. And now it's turning out that raising turkeys is even harder than raising ducks. So the turkeys are growing faster than I expected them to, and they're jumping out of the bathtub, which is what I use it for a brooder.
Wait, so you have ducks, chickens, and turkeys?
Well, the turkeys are just little baby chicks right now, but they are already too big for me.
Oh.
So I'm going to have to get them a coop to put them outside. Usually I let them, until they get their feathers, I usually keep chicks in the bathtub in, you know, and keep them warm there. Hmm. So this is favorite chicken. She's the only one who survived from all the predators that went after my chickens. She's the smartest one. She was actually lowest on the totem pole. Everybody was picking on her, and she survived, and they died, which I think is quite interesting.
Seems like she's kind of looking around cautiously.
Yeah, but she's brave. She's, you know, Oreo is right there, and she's getting closer and closer and closer to see what's going to happen. She's a very smart chicken.
See, because I've always been a city boy, I don't know anything about farm animals. I mean, once you get past dogs and cats, I'm a lost ball in high weeds. Oreo is so adorable.
Yeah, and you can see he's not trying to kill her. He wants to play with her.
Right. He wants a pal.
Yeah, right. And she's cautious because she knows he's a predator kind of genetics.
Right.
She knows what a predator looks like because she's seen them before. But she's also very brave because look, she's sitting there. She's going to lay an egg on that pillow. You can see it's a rainbow colored pillow. And there he sits wondering, I wonder how I can get closer to that chicken. Okay, and these are two new ducks that we got. Their names are Frida and Francie. And one of them, Frida, really does not, something is wrong. I'm not sure what it is. Maybe she's blind, but she doesn't seem to know how to find her way out of a paper bag or back into a paper bag. She's so over here, the flock of ducks that I now have are Joey and Petunia and Francie and Frida. But Frida is the one who was kind of awkward. Can you see how awkward she is?
Okay, which one is she?
She's the one who made those weird movements.
I don't know duck moves. What's weird? I'm not bright about farm animals. I'm sorry. I'm ignorant.
Okay, so the little short one, that's Joey. He's the drake.
On the right.
That the darker Joey. One. Okay. Yeah. Okay. And this is Petunia. She's a survivor of the female ducks that we first had. Now, Francie and Frida and Joey are actually descendants of my first flock of ducks, because I would sell eggs to Jessica and she would hatch them. And that's...
Wow.
Yeah.
Okay, I know you said earlier that two of them are out like on their own tonight. Which are the two that are out?
Well, it's Joey and Francie. I think he doesn't want Francie wandering alone, so he's escorting her because she is not sure that the coop is a safe place to be.
Okay. Because, Joey was the darker one, right?
Yeah.
Okay, I remember which one he was.
He's the male. Yeah. Okay.
Okay. We need to go out and search for them now. Let's get them back home.
I will listen. I will as soon as we finish our broadcast. I'll go see if they're still out there.
I know this is a side point to that, but how much property do you have? I mean, how far is it to anybody who could bother them?
Well, I mean, I have 10 acres, but the 10 acres contain predators such as coyotes and foxes and skunks and raccoons.
Skunks are predators?
Well, I don't know for sure.
Oh, okay,
but I mean,
okay.
You know, they don't look that different from raccoons. So.
Okay. Well, you don't like put up keep out at the edge of the property to make sure they don't come in?
I don't know how to do that.
you don't speak fox and raccoon?
No, I don't. So I was told that having a dog that marks his territory is probably the best way.
This is an interesting experiment. I cannot wait to find out how this goes.
Well, I'm not sure because none of the participants in the experiment know what I'm trying to do. You know, the ducks are probably angry with me that I brought a dog into the equation because the dog is scary. And I don't know really whether it's going to turn out okay or not.
Right.
But I just, so here's the thing. I want to give them freedom. I think it's better for them and the eggs will be better if they do get to roam. And then I don't have to buy as much feed because they do actually feed themselves on bugs and things that they find.
Good point.
So all of that is great. And it worked for about 2 years until suddenly this fox showed up and then my flock was decimated. But I'm concerned about everything. So for instance, Jessica said, well, you're going to have the dog neutered. And I said, I don't do that to my dogs. And she said, well, then whenever a female is in heat, he's going to leave. And so we're sort of trying to figure out what to do about that. But there are these electrical invisible fences and you can put a collar on a dog and he can't leave the perimeter. and all of this kind of stuff. I don't know.
Theoretically, I've known dogs that go right past that, especially when he smells somebody in heat.
Yeah, so I don't know what to do, but I'm trying to keep everybody's dignity, you know, and let everybody have their freedom. And that's dangerous. That's always dangerous. Right. It's dangerous for the dog not to be neutered. You could just as well say it's dangerous for a man not to be neutered, you know, because, you know, having all of your faculties intact also means that you can make mistakes, right?
That's one way to look at it. Yeah.
Yeah. So we can go back to Podkayne now and talk about freedom for children. You know, how much freedom should they have? How much supervision should they have?
You know, I mean, this isn't really the core subject and it's certainly not Podkayne, but I have to say, just to expose my own biases, I came from a personal social background, my own family background, where I expected children to be tightly controlled by their parents, simply because that's the way we were raised. And of course, you know, that's just the right way to do things. And it took me a long time to start realizing, you know, that's really not so healthy for the children. But then on the other hand, I see examples of children just with no boundaries of any sort who just go wild. And it's a really seriously good question to say, okay, where exactly are proper healthy boundaries? And I don't pretend to know that. And since I haven't had children, I'm probably the last who should lecture parents on how they should do it. So you probably are more qualified to speak on this subject.
I'm not saying that I haven't made mistakes. I think part of being a parent is making mistakes. And
should we call your daughter and ask?
yeah. She can tell you all about my mistakes. Okay. Julia has something to say. So Julia says, I was a well-behaved child on my own, but my sister was allowed freedom and more wild as a teen. She grew up fast, though, owns a house, and is soon to be a grandmother. Yeah, so that's really also part of it. Some of us are more cautious, and even though our parents do allow us a lot of freedom, we don't get into as much mischief.
Right.
Because that's our, you know, that's our
just person. Who we are.
Yeah. And then there are other people who will try everything, and they'll crash and burn sometimes. But if they don't, then they're much stronger people for having had the experience of being able to try things. Now, I'm not a person who thinks that children should be badly behaved toward others. That's not at all my opinion. I think in a time when children were free, they also had been disciplined about, you know, other people's rights and not crossing certain boundaries.
Mm-hmm.
I don't know
how this directly interfaces with what you're saying, but I suspect that it does. It seems to me that a lot of people they want to segregate adults from children instead of integrating things more. Yeah. And if you integrate different ages in social structures as they grow up, it seems to me that they're in a better position to learn the things that they should learn from those social interactions instead of being sloughed off and segregated somewhere where they just, it becomes Lord of the Flies or something. So
I agree with that. I think children should be surrounded by many different ages. I mean, segregating them by age at school.
I hate it.
Yeah.
Agree.
Okay.
Totally agree.
You know, and I can tell you something about when I was at the Libertarian Convention in Orlando, and I was rooting for Austin Peterson. He was hoping to get the Libertarian nomination for president in 2016. And then there was something, you know, and he was there in a debate, and there was something that he said that I disagreed with I did, you know, I've never talked about this before, but it was about whether it would be, it should be illegal to sell cocaine to a 5-year-old. And of course he said, no, it should not be legal to sell cocaine to a 5-year-old. And I thought it should be legal, but the parent should make sure the five-year-old does not consume it. And what I was thinking about was, you know, in the good old days when dad could give a child a list of things to bring from the grocery store, the child could be 5 years old. One of the things could be a bottle of whiskey.
Cigarettes, beer.
Yeah, exactly. And nobody thought that the child was allowed to have the cigarettes, the beer, the whiskey.
Right.
And if the child came home and it was obvious he had taken any of that, consumed any of that, he would have, you know, been disciplined.
Right.
And because the child knew this, the child would not take that. But I mean, also, you could send a child to the drugstore to bring home your medicine, which you actually needed in mm-hmm. order to be healthy. Right. And again, the child would not consume the medicine and would bring it home for you.
Right.
So the question isn't, should you be allowed to sell various drugs to a child? The question is, who is allowing the child to go to the store to buy those things?
Right. Who is supervising the child's time?
Right. Even if he's not actually there. So right now, when they have these ridiculous rules where a child is waiting on you at the store, but if you want to buy a certain product, such as nail polish or nail polish remover, the child says, I'm sorry, I'm not allowed to sell you that because I'm a minor.
Yeah.
That just doesn't make any sense.
You know, this is just a small anecdote on what you're talking about how things used to be different. I have a friend who is about my age who started smoking when he was 13 years old. And the way he got his cigarettes, he used to call the drugstore and have them delivered. And he would meet the guy like a block from the house and pick up something from the delivery guy who just brought them to him. And it's just fascinating how different things were back then. I mean, now there would have been, you know, some police SWAT team on him or something. So you just wonder, okay, my friend has smoked all of these years and he's ended up having some serious issues because of it. But you just wonder, how could a child of that age be smoking and neither of the parents ever figure it out? This is not, you know, make sure.
Yeah, right. Yeah. Probably the parents had some kind of a problem. And, you know, when the parents have a problem, then they have trouble supervising, right?
Yeah, you're right. Anyway, that was just a total side point. Sorry. I didn't mean to chase another rabbit.
Yeah. Angela says, I think when we crash and burn through our mistakes, we can learn from those mistakes and therefore grow.
That's true. And some of us, Angela, keep crashing and burning throughout our entire lives. And that's why.
Yeah, we never stop making mistakes.
Well, I still don't,
growing.
I still don't know what I'm going to be when I grow up, Angela. So I am total example.
Okay. But you're going to conquer the world, right?
Well, okay, that is a very good point. I'm glad you haven't forgotten the ultimate goal here.
Of course. You know, I'm one of those chess players.
Yeah, Pinky and the Brain are over here, you know, having conversations right. with me.
Yeah, and Julia says, but a woman was carded to buy Sharpies a few years ago.
What? That's awful.
Yeah. So we live in a very, very, very strange world.
I think the word is insane. Oh, I remember I read it. This is about 10 years ago. I forget where it was, but you could not buy Drano, you know, drain opener without an adult ID. Don't ask.
Yeah. And nowadays you can't buy fertilizer, I think, because somebody blew up a building using it.
So. Yeah. Because of the Oklahoma City bombing. Right.
Yeah.
Anyway, what I keep telling people, and people don't believe me, is if you want to do something bad, And unless you live in a totally locked down police state, you are going to do something bad, no matter what is, you know, forbidden. You know, you can't forbid enough things to keep everybody safe unless you become an absolute police state.
Yeah, which is the direction we certainly have gone in.
You are correct.
Let's see, what is Julia telling us? She's like to garden. Okay. I thought you said, I am like to a garden, but I was thinking in sort of biblical. I am like unto a garden.
Toys are us for kid. Yay.
Okay. Yeah. So
Julia's been in enough. We should have just brought her in as another, you know, part of the conversation.
Well, we can.
I'm kidding. I don't want to.
Yeah, she's going to co-host in April.
Okay, that's great. She always does a really nice job. So it's always nice to see her.
No, Julia, your sentence made sense. I'm just, I just went biblical on you. So anyway, we do have this collaboration, my story F and your reading of it. And
if Audible would get its act together and approve the file, everyone could hear what we've been doing.
Right. So I did put together, you know, I did put together, you know, the teaser for that. And I don't know if you got a chance to see or hear that at the beginning of the show before you got the link to come on.
No.
Okay. So
I was frantically looking for a link.
I'm sorry. Okay. Let me see. This is how it's.
Gee,
started.
Virginia, I bet you're the only person in the whole world to fail sex ed. He was in her room, lying on her bed with his head hanging upside down off the side, his fingertips barely touching the floor. Virginia sat on the bed, her arms folded around her knees. I bet I am.
All my life, I've wanted to go to Earth. Not to live, of course, just to see it. As everybody knows, Terra is a wonderful place to visit, but not to live. Not truly suited to human habitation. Personally, I'm not convinced that the human race originated on Earth. I mean to say, how much reliance should you place on the evidence of a few pounds of old
bones? You know, but that's where... Kind of hard to read when you have a chimp grooming you at the same time.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
The story sounded really good, but that narrator, there's something wrong with him. I don't know what's going on.
Well, I think it sounds very good. Your voice is very good for the part.
You know what's interesting, and I just want to tell people this, because you know this, but as soon as I read this story, I said, this reminds me of something that Heinlein might have written. Now, I'm not saying that, you know, I stole his techniques or characters or anything of that nature, but in spirit, it just reminded me of the way he wrote. So it seems to me that anybody who enjoyed Heinlein's fiction, there's especially his the fiction that he wrote, you know, for say teens, would especially like this, since there is a young, well, there's actually two young characters. I think that the relationship between them is fascinating, and I know that I have said this several times and you keep telling me you have no intention of doing this, but I want to know what happens next. So.
Okay, well, you know, who knows? I might, but that is kind of like Podkayne of Mars. I think it's the story of F is complete in and of itself. It has a form, it has a beginning, middle, and end.
Yeah. And it's fine the way it is. I just want to know what happens to Virginia when she gets to where she's going. I don't want to say where she's going, but I don't want to give it away.
Okay.
And I want to find out how she rounds out, you know, the sex ed that she didn't learn properly.
Okay. Yeah, but some things are better left to the imagination, don't you think?
Hey, when it comes to sex, Heinlein didn't leave some things to the imagination.
I know. I know.
Friday. When I read Friday, see, I had never read any of his stuff that had any sex and stuff in it. And I read Friday when I was in college and I was like, what is this?
Different. So this is why Virginia thought all of that was Heinlein's fault, you know?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Anyway, it's a very nice story, y'all. I mean, I know I is not going to toot her own horn, but it's a nice, well-rounded story. Writing a short story can be very difficult because you have to quickly develop characters. You have to put them into a situation, develop the plot very quickly, and then bring it to a resolution. And it does that in a very linear and satisfying way. And by the end of the story, you know, you're very happy with what has happened to her. So she, as I said, she's not going to tell you this, but I am. So it's a very good story.
Well, thank you. Thank you. I wrote it during a period when I was writing short stories, and it was one of three. And I thought that they needed to be science fiction because I had already written a novel, you know, my first novel, and I was trying to follow in the footsteps of Ayn Rand. And I was told, you know, it sounds like science fiction. And I wasn't trying to write science fiction. So I thought, okay, maybe science fiction is my genre. But actually, I don't have a genre, you know, I write all sorts of different things.
But the nice thing about science fiction is that you can have commentary about this world where, you know, you're not direct. You're saying things where people can take it. Because you're not directly saying things that complains about something that they believe in. You're saying it about somebody in the future. But then at some point they go, well, you know, that kind of applies to me too. So I think sometimes doing that can force people to think in ways that they weren't necessarily expecting to. So I think it's a very good, genre for, you know, to present libertarian ideas. So I think
it definitely is. Although what I found is if you go far enough back in history, it's almost like science fiction in the sense that you've got yourself a different situation. And you can still say something about the present by talking about the past.
Right. Totally. The way I learned that particular point, I was a big fan of Star Trek when I was growing up. The original. I'm old enough that the original is the only real Star Trek to me. But anyway, I'm not going to be a crotchety old man.
No. That's okay. It's that way for me too.
But the thing about it is, back then, every Star Trek episode, or I'm not going to say everyone, but almost every Star Trek episode was a self-contained morality play. And whether I completely agreed with Roddenberry's point or not, it was a well-developed, morality tale. And you don't see that about, you know, you don't see it typically anymore. It used to be a lot more common, but that way he could comment on race. He could even comment on religion in a way that you never could have put something on in the mid 60s if you didn't make it about another planet. Do you remember the episode called A Piece of the Action about this society that had based everything around imitating something in a book? Well, when I finally got old enough to understand what Roddenberry was saying, he was satirizing religion. And, you know, he was. But anyway, there's no way that he could have brought up this idea. Hey, is this a good idea to slavishly obey this thing just because it's in a book? There's no way that he could have brought that idea up if he had said it directly. But in a funny story, you know, it was an interesting point that made you think.
Well, yeah. In fact, religion often does miss the point of the book that it is dealing with, because there are, you know, different points of view on what that book might actually be saying.
Oh, absolutely. I mean, that's why we have, you know, 47,000 different Christian sects. Everybody is certain that we have the only one true meaning. The rest of you are going to hell, you know?
Right. Yeah. Yeah. So, you know, what do you think? Do you think Dr. McCoy was a specialist? He's not a bricklayer.
Well, that is true, but... I mean, you know, obviously to some extent he was a specialist, but he was also in addition to being, you know, a medical doctor, he was obviously, you know, he was basically, his real purpose in the show was to be kind of Kirk's conscience, you know. I mean, Spock and McCoy existed in this triangle with Kirk to play out the two sides of Kirk. I mean, Spock was the logical side of him. Then this is the humanist side of him over here. And these two at times were in conflict. And we could see that conflict because we could see the conflict that Kirk went through in order to make his decisions in those two characters. That's the way I see it.
Yeah, that's true. So they were sort of a trilogy or a trinity.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah, and I think, Dave, that Julia was agreeing with you about the religion issue.
Ah, okay. So it's not just me.
Right. Yeah. Yeah, the thing about Star Trek is, at the time, I was a very big Star Trek fan, but then now that, you know, we're all much older, I see that about half the fans, or maybe three quarters of the fans, took very, very socialist
interpretations
of, mm-hmm. of the show.
Yeah. And in some ways, that might have been where, to some degree, that's where Roddenberry was coming from. Yeah. I was able to enjoy it as something entirely different from that. So I can still enjoy it without, you know, without letting that bother me. Now, the newer material, I cannot watch the newer material. I think it's awful.
Yeah, but I mean, the entire science fiction community has been split into, I think, in a way that it really in the 60s and 70s, it wasn't split.
How would you define the split that you see in the science fiction community now? You're just talking about old people versus young people, or what?
No. Well, left versus right.
Ah, okay.
So have you heard about the sad puppy fiasco?
Sad puppy?
Yes, I don't even know the story.
Do I want to know the story?
It has something to do with Hugo's and who is eligible to get them. And,
oh, no.
Yeah. Yeah, the Filkers are also doing the same thing. They are dividing along the lines of left and right.
Hmm. And if I mean, and I'm purely guessing because I didn't, to be honest, I don't pay attention to who wins the Hugos and stuff like that anymore.
I don't
but I mean, my only point is, if I had my guess, I would say that the left is the one that will end up controlling the institutions and making sure that their people win the awards. Is that the way it's going?
Yeah, that's the way it's going. So can you tell me why that always happened?
The only thing I can say is because the left likes to organize more and the people on the right are a bunch of individualists who don't organize as well. Look, okay, I'm not going to totally go down this road because I could talk about this all night. Years ago, when I first started getting away from, you know, the standard way of looking at the world politically, I became active in the Libertarian Party. Here in Alabama, I became the vice chair. And I used to get so frustrated because I would sit in like 6 and 7 hour meetings of the State Libertarian Executive Committee, because I'm sitting here with maybe 6 or 8 of some of the smartest minds in the state, but they want, everybody has a different way of looking at it, and everybody thinks he's right about everything, and every little point has to be debated. And libertarians aren't really good at saying there are some things we need to just ignore and move on and deal with what we have to deal with. And as a party, I don't think socially libertarian type people are really good at organizing in order to be effective. But that's another story entirely. I was very disappointed in how that worked.
So is that why you think maybe a dictatorship run by a libertarian would do better than an organization such as the Libertarian Party?
Well, I think that there would be no such thing as a dictatorship of the libertarians, because by definition, he couldn't be.
Well, I mean, not necessarily. You know, what do you think a Galt's Gulch was? Do you think that was a democracy?
No, it wasn't a democracy, but everybody was free to be what he wanted as long as he followed the rules of the ownership, you know? I mean,
right, but it was all owned by Midas Mulligan.
Yeah, well, that's who owned it. I mean, if you had, okay, I have postulated before the thought of having an island. And not some libertarian utopia island, but an island where you just set it up as a business, mm-hmm. and set it up to be essentially a city that you run for profit. And, you know, you're going to follow the rules that I have set up to maximize my profit, blah, blah, blah. I think that would work quite nicely for a small city state. But yeah. Fortunately, if you have somebody who is in the position of saying, I am your dictator and I am also a libertarian, those two just are totally self-contradictory. If you're a libertarian, you're not going to dictate to people what they do unless it's on
you can dictate to them that they leave their neighbors alone and not take their stuff.
Well, you can dictate that they leave your stuff alone. If you dictate what two other people do among them.
No, not what two other people, but what someone does to someone else. So we actually had an island like that, David. It was called Galveston Island, and it was run by Jean Lafitte. And
you're talking about the pirate.
Well, he wasn't a pirate. He was a privateer.
Oh, totally different. Sorry.
So I wrote about that too.
That's interesting. I'll have to learn some more about that. I'm not familiar with that.
Once you get into ANCAP land, you know, anarcho-capitalism, you go down some really weird.
Oh, absolutely. Yes. Because all of us think we have it figured out.
Yeah.
And I mean, I'm being a little bit facetious when I say that, but to a degree, and that's part of the problem. Most of the people I know who feel this way, they are very bright people, but very bright people can come to different conclusions, and they can sit around arguing day after day after day instead of getting anything done.
Well, yeah, but if you're really bright, you don't really want to argue. You just go off and do your own thing.
Yeah, I don't know. I know a lot of really bright people who spend a lot of time arguing, you know, just anyway. I'm sick of arguing. That's why I don't do it online anymore.
I don't like to do that either.
I used to be dumb enough, not call it naive enough. Okay, I'll be nice and call it naive. I used to be naive enough to believe that, you know, when the internet first came around on message boards and things of that nature, that, well, if I just explain my ideas clearly enough, obviously everybody would agree because I'm showing the logic. Doesn't work that way. And I'm finally to the point that it's like, I will tell you what I believe if you want to know. And I'm more than happy to explain my views, but I'm not going to argue with you about it. That's just where I am.
Yeah. Well, the thing is, one of the things we have to realize is not everybody has the same values. So True. We don't all have the same goals.
Correct.
And a lot of times when people disagree about what should be done, it's because they want to live in a completely different world in which different things happen.
Well, and one of the things on that very point that I think people have to accept, they have to accept the fact that it's okay for different cities, communities, whatever you want to call it, different people to voluntarily band together and live according to rules that I don't like.
Yeah. Yeah.
And that's tough.
Yeah. The only problem is that for some reason, we can start out with city states, but somehow we end up with empires.
I know. I've never seen a counterexample, but maybe I'm just idealistic enough to hope that we are going to find a way.
Yeah.
And maybe I'm an idiot.
Yeah. The problem is that some people really want, they really want to be part of an empire.
You're right. And a lot of people just consider it, you know, this is natural. This is the natural way things are or should be. And they just don't see anything the way we do.
Now, I have a question here from unknown profiler. I'm not sure what it means. So help me, David. What does it mean? Why don't have big brains like us?
I don't know. Apparently, unknown profiler has a big brain, and he or she is asking why you and I do not have brains as good as his. Maybe I don't know.
Okay. Well,
I mean, I'm being silly, but I don't really know.
Okay. Yeah. Right. Okay. Oh, he's talking about chimps.
Wait, is this a chimp writing in? Maybe.
I don't know. I no idea.
What kind of audience are you attracting, Aya?
I attract a mixed audience of people who are only interested in chimpanzees. People are interested in chimpanzees and also other topics.
And when they tune in and find out it's someone like me, they're like, it's not Beau tonight. Let's turn her off.
Right. Well, what can we do? But Beau was interested in Podkayne of Mars. So
good. Should we let Beau create like, you know, a list of favorite Heinlein books? And give us reviews.
Oh, unknown profiler says he just watches for ASMR. I don't know that Bo has a list of favorite books. And Julia says that you are ASMR. So where was that? She said that. You are very ASMR, David. So
I don't really know what that means. Okay, Julia, you're going to have to educate me. I am totally lost.
Well, you have a nice voice. That's why I chose you as a narrator.
ASMR. Okay, I'm going to have to figure out what that... I don't know what that means.
Okay. I'm not sure what it means either, but apparently Bo is ASMR, and so are you.
Oh, okay. I am too dumb to be participating in this conversation, so I'm going to have to do some research. But okay. Julia, if it's a good thing, I'll say thank you. And if you're saying something nasty about me, you're in trouble.
Julia only says good things.
She knows I'm kidding. I can tell she has a very great personality.
Yeah. And, I'm not going to answer the question about sneezing, so.
What is this, medical advice channel now?
Well, actually, a lot of people think that Beau is better than the average physician, and I tend to agree with that.
Bo might be smarter than some of the clients I deal with, but, you know, I don't need to tell them that.
So, David, is it okay to ask you what's happening in the housing market? I understand we're going into a recession. Does that mean housing prices will go down or up?
Theoretically, we should be seeing it go down. But look, I do not claim to be a psychic. I have been expecting prices to go down for at least the last year. And there has been some softness. It's not insane like it was a year and a half ago. But I have been expecting it to really collapse and, you know, for us to see 20, 30, you know, 40% drops. And we haven't seen that yet. So, I still expect it to happen at some point, but as I said, my crystal ball is super fuzzy. So I just deal with reality as I see it. I don't pretend that I can tell you what's coming. The funny thing is the people who do tell you that, if you listen to them, a lot of them will say all sorts of different things. And the ones who happen to be right will then later say, see, I was right about this, but they don't tell you the stuff they were wrong about in the other areas. And I'd rather just say, I'm not smart enough to know, but I'll help you to figure out what makes sense today. You know, like I was telling people last year who were interested in buying houses, if you don't have to buy a house right now, don't. If you have a way to sell a house and live someplace without buying, this is a great time to do that because you can sell high. And when prices go down, you can buy something in a year or two. That was the advice that I had. But frankly, most people get to the point that they're just like, I want a new house, and they're going to go do it, whether it makes sense or not. So my advice.
Well, it depends on whether they have a job. And so, right.
Well, yeah, if they can't get financing.
Right.
The saddest thing I've ever seen in that regard, we had a guy who was buying a house and he had his financing in order. Everything was fine. He had a very good job with a law firm. And it was like the day before his house was supposed to close and everything was lined up. And one of the higher ups from the company called him in just to say, look, I am not supposed to tell you this yet, but we're laying a bunch of people off next week and you're going to be among them. And I'd rather just let you know so you don't put yourself in debt.
Wow.
Yeah. He had to back out the day before his closing, but fortunately he didn't end up in a position where he couldn't pay his mortgage and got repossessed. So.
Yeah. I understand a lot of people are being laid off now, and it's usually in the tech companies and middle management.
Right. That's true. But if you want to work in fast food, there's plenty of jobs.
Yeah. So that's kind of a consolation for anybody who doesn't have a high job.
Right.
I think the lower people, their jobs are safe.
And, you know, lest it sound as though I'm making fun of people in fast food, one of the things that a lot of people do not understand, you can make good money as a manager. You know, if you can get to the GM level at a lot of the franchise stores, like a GM of a McDonald's or something of that nature, you can make a lot of money. I mean,
and everybody thinks that you're the manager of your local McDonald's, right?
I have heard it typically about when I'm in Chick-fil-A and when I'm in another place called Jack's. It's not Jack in the Box. It's another franchise. It's another one here called Jack's. A lot of times when I'm in those places, yes, what I is talking about, it's been a running joke among my friends because people, I don't know why, if they have some concern, a lot of times they will end up coming to me and saying, aren't you the manager here? Can you help me with so-and-so? And I'm like, I'm just a customer here. And I don't know why. Do I give off manager vibes? I don't know. I've never figured it out.
Yeah. Well, no. It's your voice. You have imperial voice.
Oh, okay. I have to tell you something. And I mentioned this on Facebook yesterday just because I thought it was funny. A real estate agent called me about a listing that I have from Minneapolis yesterday. And she, after we started talking, she said, you really should do some voice acting work. And she does it part time. And she was telling me that I should do it. And she said, you really should, you know, your voice should be on the phone system at your office instead of that awful voice that's on there. And I said, that's the owner. I don't think I'm going to pass that along to him.
Wow.
So anyway, I found that very funny, but I'm not going to pass that along to my friend who is the owner.
Okay, well, let's hope that he's not watching.
I will not tell him about it.
Okay. All right. But you should be a voice actor, and you are, in a way, you know, by being a narrator of F.
You know, I will say, and I don't want to get too deep into this because it would bore people, but narrating a short story is a lot tougher than you think it is, because you don't want all of the voices of the characters to sound exactly the same, and you want to have enough emotion for different people. It's not as easy as you think, and the technical part was a lot more difficult. So it took, this is only like a 24-minute short story, and it took me weeks to get it right, and a lot of that was mainly just getting, you know, Audible's technical requirements. I had to learn stuff about technical part about audio that I didn't even know existed. So it was nuts. And I still have my fingers crossed that they're going to approve our files, but.
They will. Okay. And actually I didn't have to give you very much direction. I was very happy with the readings that you sent me. You know, I've had other narrators where I would go, no, this has to be stressed here, and that has to be stressed, you know. And I've even had people who, now those were not narrators I chose, but who tried to audition and they were trying to do falsettos as a woman's voice and things like that. So
this is what Virginia is supposed to sound like.
Right, exactly. So I'm, you didn't have any problem like that. You knew what to do. So.
Okay. Well, I'm just eager for it to go on sale, and you know, you just start selling millions of copies from all of Bo's fans.
Well, yeah, I'm not sure it's going to be Bo's fans. So we're hoping maybe Heinlein's fans would be a better.
No, but you can tell people that when they buy this, that it will, you know, help, it helps buys, you know, help support, you know, Bo's food and medical supplies and stuff like that.
Oh, speaking of which, we do have sponsors. We have, we have people who are members of my channel. So I made them a little thank you. Unfortunately, that's the end of it. So let's start over here. See if it'll play. It's William Manket, ZippedUpKitz, Sparrow 13, and Jenna. Okay. Thank you, members.
I recognize William's name from his comments in the past.
Yes, apparently he's too busy today. Now, the last time he said he finished all his chores, and so he had time to attend the live stream. But it's possible he had some classes to study for, papers to write, or chores to do, so he wasn't able to make it tonight. But anyway, we thank him.
William, I hope you get to listen to this tonight, and I hope you'll join her next week, because we always notice you.
Right, we do. We definitely do, and Angela is always here, too, so we appreciate her being here. And of course, Julia, who is going to host, not next week, but all through the month of April, Julia is going to be co-hosting.
Nice.
Yeah, yeah. So, David, what is your next project?
My next project right now is to go have dinner. I didn't have time earlier.
Oh, no. We kept you from your dinner. Okay, so I'll go and round up my ducks. And yeah, you have a great dinner.
The truth of the matter is I could fail to eat for the next 3 months and I'd be fine. I've been storing up fat for a while. people think I'm pregnant with twins.
Oh, I don't think so. I don't think so. I think it's good to eat regular meals. Okay. So another 6 months and I will get back to you. And hopefully both of us will be millionaires from selling the from the royalties off of F.
And hopefully some other things in my life will have calmed down and I can have something interesting to report. We'll see.
Okay. Well, thank you for coming on and have a very good meal tonight.
Thanks. Have a good night. And
bye-bye.
And go find.